Tarzan of the Apes, brought to you from out the pages of Edgar Rice Burroughs' fascinating book. The entire tribe seems to be assembled.
I have no fear of death, not even this. When the time comes, I'll drink without hesitation.
If we refuse to drink, we'll be tortured. If we drink, we die.
Is it possible that we could impose our superior magic upon these pagans and perhaps postpone this poison cup ceremony?
Perhaps, as I suggested before, some ritual from the Book of the Dead.
For example?
The raising of Isis by Osiris.
Rather fantastic, Philander. And besides, we have no mummy to raise. And I seriously doubt our ability to raise it if we had it.
Monsieur le Professeur.
Yes, Darno.
I have been talking to Lakido. He says drink and have no fear.
By Jove, what cheerful advice.
What else did he say, Darno?
Nothing. He was being watched. But I trust him. I shall drink.
Oh, yes. So will we all, if we have to.
If, monsieur, have you another plan?
Professor Porter and Philander are to attempt something which I do not think they quite know. I say, do you know I'd completely forgotten till now? The rocket!
What do you mean?
The rockets we brought from the ship. Couldn't you substitute one or even two for the mummy and the rite you spoke of?
Clayton, I really believe you've hit upon a solution.
Pierre, make your preparations. And keep the natives' attention away from me. I shall get the rockets.
Here comes the chief. Postpone the poison drinking competition if you can.
Bordo. Wimby, Nadawa?
Nadawi Wimby, Kidogo Kindi.
No.
Whatever you said, it worked, Darno.
Heureusement, oui, monsieur. I told him that as soon as the great priest had performed his magic, we would all drink.
Will we perform the ceremony, Professor? And can I do anything?
Suppose we perform the rite just where we are. You, Clayton, must play the part of the hawk-headed one. Take a short stick and the rocket when Darno brings it.
Yes, what then?
You have seen a picture, I suppose. Or perhaps a statue of a mummy.
Yes, of course.
Then fold your arms across your breast in that manner. Look straight ahead, neither to right nor left.
You can trust me.
And I suppose, Professor, I had better draw the sacred symbols on the ground.
Yes, Philander. And be sure to cover Clayton's movements when he places the rocket on the ground.
Why, see. Here, monsieur, is the rocket.
I do not think I will see. Now then, Clayton, place the rocket.
And be sure to place it pointing to the blacks, not toward us.
Cannibals watch Professor Porter as he walks solemnly toward the council fire. Darno's sailors stand with their arms outstretched as Philander inscribes before them the mystic symbols. His hands folded across his breast, Professor Porter stands before the fire, intoning the chant of the ancient Egyptian sun worshippers.
Ashbu seket metu tu en baka Aneb Osiris et Hepkepera.
The natives lean forward. The professor's intoning wakes in their breasts a corresponding chord of religious sympathy. The witch doctor, morose and sullen, squats in the shadow, a half sneer on his hideously painted face. Professor Porter raises his arms above his head, closes his eyes.
Ashbu seket metu.
His body sways from side to side as he repeats the incantation.
Et hepkepera.
Clayton, hidden behind Philander, lights the rocket. There's a hiss, a blasting shower of sparks. Like a living thing of fire, the green rocket shoots toward the blacks. As they start to run, the rocket leaps into the air. It turns and flashes a gleaming, darting snake of vivid green fire towards the sacrificial altar. The witch doctor leaps aside. The rocket passes him. It turns again, hits the stone, soars into the air, and streaks over the chief's house. Leaving a trail of sparks behind, it loses itself in the jungle. The natives throw themselves on the ground, faces in the dust before Professor Porter. As the early morning sun floods the clearing where Lord Greystoke built his hut, it shines upon Jane Porter and Tarzan as they drop leisurely, branch by branch, from the upper jungle terrace to the soft green moss below.
Thanks, Whiteskin. But I don't believe that I'll ever get quite used to traveling through the treetops at breakneck speed.
Speed?
Yes, speed. Same as quick.
Tarzan sits down at the foot of a giant tree as Jane crosses the clearing and goes to the hut.
Jane, go inside. afraid. White skin go hut?
No. Jane go hut. White skin look.
Almost as dusty and unused looking as when we first discovered it. Oh, here's the revolver. Thank goodness the black didn't take me. Now, I wonder if there are any more cartridges in the box. Cecil said that I would always find them. Oh, yes. Here they are. Two packages of them. Now, I'll feel much safer. I suppose I'd better try this gun again. It seems to be all right. What's that?
Jane runs to the door. There on the edge of the clearing are several great apes. She clutches the gun in her hand and shouts to Tarzan.
Tarzan, quick! Go hot, quick!
She stops as she sees the expression on Tarzan's face. The ape man almost smiles as he watches the great brutes make their way across the clearing toward him.
White skin!
Jane, frightened?
Yes, white skin.
Jane, frightened? No. Sticker, Gazan, Pop, Mungo.
Tarzan rises and places his bronzed arm about Jane's slender shoulders as the apes approach. They chatter excitedly among themselves as they watch this hairless she. Gazan, Tika's Belu, comes forward eagerly, unafraid.
Oh, Gazan!
The baby ape dances up and down in sheer delight at hearing Jane speak its name.
Andua, Sela Santo, Dak, Armangani, Jane.
Tarzan tells the apes that they must protect Jane from the other beasts of the jungle. He explains that she, Jane, is to be accepted as one of the tribe. Little Gazan, paying no attention to the warnings of Tika, his mother, comes forward and takes Jane by the hand. Tika gathers courage, moves closer, and stretches out a huge paw to Jane. Jane shrinks back.
Oh.
Jane, no frightened. Tika no take, Jane. Tika, talk, Mungo, see. Talk, tell Jane. Sabor, Numa come.
Yes, White Skin, I think I understand. You mean that the apes will look out for me, guard me against Numa and Sabor?
Yes.
Tarzan nods his head vigorously as he realizes that Jane has understood. The apes turn away. Little Gazan leaps and dances after his mother. Tarzan and Jane follow. And as the great apes take to the trees, Tarzan lifts Jane in his arms and strides into the jungle trail. Back in the cannibal village, Professor Porter, Philander, Clayton, Darno, and the sailors await anxiously the results of their magic.
I don't like the look on that witch doctor's face, Darno.
No, monsieur. In the first place, he sees that we have affected the natives, and he is liable to lose his life if they decide to believe in us.
And his undignified efforts to get out of the way of the rocket. He evidently felt that very keenly.
I suppose, in order to live up to what is expected of us, we should do very little talking.
No one is paying very much attention to us now. They're all watching the witch doctor trying to convince the chief of something.
Very earnest talk, too, that he's making. I wonder...
I do not wonder. I know that he is trying to convince the chief that no matter what our medicine magic may be, we still should drink the poison.
I'm very much afraid that you are right, Darno.
Then there is nothing to do but drink.
So it would seem. Rather a ghastly way to go out. I'd much rather put up a scrap.
But we must not forget what Nakido said, that we should drink and not feel.
Yes, but can we trust Nakido?
Yes, Darno,
I'll admit that he has on several occasions tried to help us. But great Scott, to drink an unknown poison!
Hush! Here comes the chief. And that is the ceremonial procession of the test by poison.
Oh, well, what of it? Let's drink.
The blacks stand motionless as the chief advances with the poison. With steady hands, Professor Porter takes the gourd, raises it slowly to his lips, and drinks.
Kasori nami, kasori nami, kasori nami, Katori nami, Katori nami, Katori nami, Katori nami.